how lucky I am. I have become an introducer for the past 2-3 days. Very respected guests on the dais, Professor Sunaina Singh, Honorable Vice Chancellor of IFLU, well-wisher and friend philosopher, both of them, Professor Faizan Mustafa, Vice Chancellor of NALSAR, our Pro Vice Chancellor, my colleagues, participants, and dear students, organizing secretary, and the students of MBA. For the past 2 days, 6 technical sessions have unfolded many of the unheard, untouched, untalked about themes, sub-themes. I was wondering yesterday, one gentleman, an engineering college professor, IIT professor from West Bengal, was talking about ethics, value system in management and technology, and some was trying to emphasize on the beneficiaries of RUSA, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, and the affairs and the status of the minorities, particularly the Muslims, in the country, insofar as education is concerned. Sirs, it was a wonderful academic exercise for all of us for the past 2 days, and on top of it, it is a wonderful thing. Our colleagues from the non-teaching sector also participated with beautiful papers. Dr. Munawar yesterday presented a paper on the melodies and the remedies of AICT and NCT, governance of education. Very wonderful topics, madam. You will be very happy to know when the book comes out. And today I have been very fortunate to introduce the organizing secretary asked me what work I will do today in the valedictory. I said, same like yesterday, I have the good fortune of speaking about my well-wishers and elders. And here is Professor Sunaina Singh. She is actually busy in academics. At the same time, Professor Faizan Mustafa was just now telling that she is also popular in the press these days for various reasons. Madam, with permission from you, I would like to take 3 minutes to introduce to the learned audience here, academicians, about your achievements. I won't call it as biodata or curriculum vitae. It is a list of achievements of Madam Sunaina. Women empowerment is here. Women empowerment, women, she is the embodiment of knowledge. She is running a university with lot of problems and problems only. And that speaks of how the society is respecting her. Professor Sunaina Singh is an internationally acknowledged academician. As an able and committed administrator, Professor Sunaina Singh, the Vice Chancellor of IFLU University, has distinguished herself in many areas, having 7 books to her credit. She has published innumerable research articles which have created milestones in the domain of knowledge and acquainted with the West, with the Indian pedagogical system, epistemological concerns, and university administration. As the president of the Shastri Indo-Canadian Institute, a bi-national research organization, she strengthened the bilateral education ties of the two nations by taking some path-breaking initiatives. Professor Singh is a recipient of Commonwealth Academic Staff Scholarship and the Postdoctoral Faculty Award from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs Canada. She held the Indian Studies National Chair at Shanghai University of China. For her distinguished contributions to the field of academics, she has been conferred the Rashtriya Gaurava Award, which is a very prestigious award. The National College of Nottingham, United Kingdom, honored her by awarding a certificate on international leadership development. United Kingdom honored her a certificate of leadership. In the year January 2013, Sunaina Singh was conferred the prestigious Chanakya Award for Excellence in Good Governance by the Public Relations Council of India in association with the Press Council of Mumbai at the 8th Global Communication Conclave in February 2014. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Singh heads many national and international panels on higher education. Since 14th May 2012, under her dynamic leadership, the FLU, English and Foreign Languages University, has been marching forward to reach the zenith of educational excellence. Her mission is inclusive education par excellence, apart from Hyderabad, Lucknow, and Shillong campuses. Under Professor Sunaina Singh's Vice Chancellorship, the university now boasts of a 100-acre campus in Kerala. She is committed for its all-round development in that particular campus by establishing a FLU university. Professor Singh, as a person and academic administrator, has always believed in work and working for the development of education. And she touches many hearts and inspires many as an able leader. She is widely known for her scholarship and integrity. When we hear her, we will come to know. Here is a person, Dr. Professor Sunaina Singh. Secondly, we have very, very distinguished international orator in the person of our friend, philosopher guide, Professor Faizan Mustafa Saab. When he speaks, no words can match to match it. That is the scholarship, that is the oration of. He has stolen the gold medal from Aligarh Muslim University. As a ranker, distinction, he has secured distinction. He is a first ranker in LLM, LLB, and since the days, student days, he was in student union also. From student days, he has been known for his scholarship, known for his oratory. Today, fortunately, very few universities in the country, law universities particularly, have a person of this caliber as the vice chancellor. He is not only vice chancellor for a particular sphere of activity, he is wanted in human rights, criminal cases, right to information, so many things he has specialized. I will read out. You please lend me your ears for 3 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, I have great pleasure in introducing Professor Faizan Mustafa Saab, presently the Vice Chancellor of Nalsar University of Hyderabad. He was the founder Vice Chancellor of National Law University at Varissa. He has also served as the Dean Faculty of Law, Aligarh Muslim University, and also he was the Registrar of AMU. He is the founder Director of Kalinga Institute of KIIT Law School. He is the advisor to National Law School and Judicial Academy at Assam. He is known for his institution building abilities and capabilities. He is a democratic leadership. He is also visiting professor to several reputed institutions in India and abroad. He has visited and lectured in several countries of the world. He has earlier served in UAE and Africa. Professor Mustafa Saab is a gold medalist in LLM from Aligarh. He completed his PhD in copyright law, very important law, where in which we find hardly a few hands, few scholars. Completed his PhD in copyright law. He also has a diploma in international and comparative human rights from International Institute of Human Rights, Strasbourg, France. He was also consulted in the drafting of Eritrean constitution. He was the Ambedkar, he is the Ambedkar of Eritrean constitution framing. And Asian Human Rights Charter of Asian Human Rights Commission, which is very distinguished achievement of Hong Kong. As a keen researcher and avid academician, Dr. Mustafa has authored several books and has about 100 national and international papers and articles to his credit. Supreme Court of India has also quoted his article in its decision on right to die. He has worked in unexplored areas like copyright, copyright law, HIV law, Article 356, strict liability law, freedom of information law, religious conversion law, right to die, mandatory death sentence, etc. much before the Indian Parliament legislated on these issues and Indian judiciary delivered landmark decisions on these subjects. He regularly writes for the national dailies. He was a member of several search committees for the appointment of vice chancellors of various national universities. He is also the member of governing bodies, academic councils, senates, executive councils of various universities in the country. I have great pleasure in welcoming and introducing Professor Faizan Mustafa, sir. Welcome to you, sir. I have also, for those who are our participants, I must also introduce my Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor, sir, who was a civil servant, who is an academic administrator and specialized in various fields. He is guiding us. He is guiding the destiny of this university. We are very happy, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, with all love and affection, I want to announce here today is his birthday. I request Professor Faizan Mustafa to offer this garland. Thank you very much. Let this be an academic seminar. We wish Dr. Khaja Shahid Saab 100 years. God bless him. And thank you for giving a patient here.
Yeah, thank you, sir. This was Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Sahab, Director of Distance Education and in charge Dean, School of Commerce and Business Management. Proceeding to the other part of the session, I request Professor Faizan Mustafa Sahab to address this occasion. He gives a keynote address by Professor Faizan Mustafa Sahab.
It's a serious business to have valedictory, yet I have to say, the Honorable President of this session, the birthday boy. And I honored his wish. You know, I tried my best not to come for this function. I had made a commitment to Dr. Shahida for 10th, and I tried my best, you know, to convince Iqbal Saab and then also Pro Vice Chancellor that I am committed. But as my senior in Aligarh, he, you know, very rudely overruled me and said, nothing doing, you have to come. And what a pleasure it is after the huge embarrassment by Iqbal Saab in reading out that, knowing that it is Shahid Bhai's birthday. Many, many happy returns of the day, sir. My esteemed colleague and senior, the chief guest of this session, Professor Sunaina Singh, who is a scholar in her own right, and let me say on her behalf, there is no women empowerment in this. So she got everything, you know, by virtue of her own scholarship. The Dean of the School of Management and Commerce, Professor K.R. Iqbal Ahmed Sahab, Dr. Fatima, other colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. The valedictory address should ideally be read. So I will read something, whatever I could dictate to my PS in 24 hours which Shahid Bhai gave me. But having looked at the kind of papers you have, I'm sure that in that address, I would be able to touch upon the various facets of higher education which you discussed in last 2 days. But let me very briefly, in next 1.5 minute, say a few things. As a vice chancellor of a university and knowing little bit about the university administration, these are just bullet points, and then I'll read the keynote address. I think we have highly over-regulated higher education sector. I don't think there is any other country where universities have so many masters. So you have UGC, AICT, BCI, DCI, and Architecture Council, and this council, and that council. And from Kothari Commission and Radhakrishnan Commission, there is no commission which has not criticized this over-regulation of higher education, but somehow nothing has happened. When Kapil Sibal took over as HRD minister, you know, a great lawyer in his own right, he said, I will come up with 6 bills which will liberate, you know, higher education from the clutches of UGC and several other regulators. But the men went out to telecommunication, and nothing came out of those 6 bills. So we, at the end of this parliament's tenure, we are where we were in 2009. Third, I believe that, and this I would also touch in my keynote address more specifically, but here I am making a point which after looking at your papers, I thought that it is important for me to mention. We feel that in terms of funding, we are not adequately funded, and there is no doubt about it. Yet, if you look at the output from the universities, then probably we are not doing our job that well. And in output, I am not too much into the patents. Because even if you look at IITs, the amount which is invested in research and the number of patents you get, there is no match. It is 1:100 or so. That is the ratio. But more importantly, there was no paper on this. That's why I feel that this is an issue in higher education which we need to look at, and particularly as I talk in MANUU, where, you know, there is some focus on the vocational education as well. I believe this is an important point. Now, whatever research we do in universities, this research, including researches in sciences or in engineering, ultimately may help me in becoming associate professor and professor. That's it. So I may get 4 or 5 patents, and they are good enough to make me a professor in any university in India. That's it. But what really happens to the research which I have done? That research is never converted in India into a marketable commodity. And society never benefits from the researches which are done in Indian universities. And this, I believe, is a very serious lacuna in our higher education system. Because in India, we do not have what is called a university spin-off. We do not have university startups. If you look at Japan, or even Canada or US, of course, they have specific laws also on this. The public-funded universities are supposed to set up industries, are supposed to convert their researches into marketable commodities. I will come up to this theme because I'm suggesting in my keynote address that many universities in India should become companies, a kind of companies. But here I am saying, if we convert our research into marketable commodities and manage our intellectual property rights better, of course, when I did copyright, you know, nobody in country knew about IPR, and that was way back. Now you have a number of great experts in intellectual property rights, yet our university management of IP is in a miserable state. And I believe if we set up university spin-offs, the universities would become financially viable on their own. And since we won't be depending on UGC for funds, then this regulation will automatically will not affect us. In any case, the Supreme Court has said that unaided private institutions would have the highest amount of autonomy. And finally, I believe, since I have not touched at all in my keynote address the distance education thing, because it slipped from my mind that Manu is also doing courses in distance mode. But look, distance mode is one area which shows what importance we attach to higher education. You did not have any council for this. You had that DEC under, and IGNU was looking after. Then somebody realized, well, IGNU does not have this power, so the council was dissolved. And this has again gone to UGC, which is not a great thing to happen, because the formal education and distance education are two different ball games. Finally, coming to university administration and taking advantage of Shahid Bhai, who has administrative experience from Jamia, and also Professor Sunaina Singh, let me share with you, it is very difficult to run a university today. I have interesting RTIs, you know, because university is a small setup, so vice chancellor is a bride. So how many days a vice chancellor is in university or outside university, the whole university knows it. Isn't so? I have interesting RTIs. I would like to share just two of them, which I recently got. So what amount of money has been spent by NALSA on the food which was served when all these guests and others came on the convocation, from first convocation? And you know, which one was the lowest scored by various caterers? So I have to do this kind of research. Or, and this is for Professor Sunaina Singh, how many students in NALSA in all these years from its inception at various stages went into depression? And what did the university do to bring them or take them out of depression? Now tell me which file is maintained on this and from where I collect this information. But that is how it is. Don't think that anyone who is your vice chancellor or pro vice chancellor is having a great time. I believe the grace of all positions is gone in this country. And we take some kind of sadistic pleasure in disgracing people who are running institutions. So be it the prime minister or the president or, you know, speaker, all institutions, you know, we have that kind of crisis in the country that in our conversation, the decency is something which we believe is not any more important. And finally, I can go back to what I plan to say, and let me read for you my keynote address. Now, education is powerful and pervasive agent for all-round development of individual. The cherished goal of education is the development and enhancement of seekers' knowledge through the process of inquiry. But if the curiosity or quest for knowledge is to be fruitful, it must be associated with most modern techniques of acquisition of knowledge. You had sessions on ICT. The father of nation has said that the true meaning of education is harmonious development of head, heart, and hand. That is enlightenment of mind, compassion, and dignity of labor. Swami Vivekanand has also shown us a way as to the goal of education when he said, and I quote, "We must have life building, man building, and character building education," unquote. You had papers on ethics and for liberation from ignorance of our interaction with nature. It stands for innovation and adventure of ideas. Science and technology have always been recognized as most basic fundamental prescription for prosperity, prestige, and status, which a common man aims to enjoy. The countries which have implemented this basic formula do enjoy a very high standard of living, because standard of living in any country is directly proportional to the educational levels of its masses. It is an old saying, to build a better nation, build better individuals. Perspective education is indeed sovereign remedy for all economic ills. Martin Carnot rightly observed that because knowledge is the most highly valued commodity in the global economy, nations have little choice but to increase their investment in education. Progressive nations continue to invest heavily in order to be at the forefront. Sweden leads with an investment of 8.2% of its GDP on its education. In contrast, we spend just about 3% of our GDP on education. Our investment in education is not only lower than the global average of 4.8%, but it is also below several low-income and least developing countries whose average is approximately 3.3%. The situation is indeed quite alarming as we spend just 0.1% of our GDP on higher education. India has certainly come a long way, and Shahid Bhai in his message in the souvenir has mentioned this. From 28 universities and 578 colleges at the commencement of the constitution to over, to be precise, he said 677 universities and more than 35,539 colleges today. The country has the largest number of higher education institutions in the world, and some 20 million students are enrolled with the institutions of higher education in the country. The higher education sector has witnessed a tremendous growth since independence, as number of universities has jumped 23 times. And the number of colleges has registered an impressive increase of over 66 times. Similarly, the student enrollment of 3,97,000 in 1950 has surged to 1,69,75,000. The number of graduates coming out of technical colleges was slightly over 7 lakh in 2011-12. However, it is disgusting to note, and that is a matter of concern, that as per McKinsey report, 75% of our technical graduates and more than 85% of general graduates are unemployable. The Indian higher education system is thus plagued with outdated curricula and ill-equipped libraries. In 2011, FICCI Higher Education Survey said 48% of universities and 69% of colleges were lacking infrastructure. MANUU, by the way, has best of the infrastructure. Similarly, there is acute shortage of faculties. 45% of positions of professors, 51% of positions of associate professors, and 52% positions of assistant professors are lying vacant in Indian universities. Even in our institutions of excellence, like national law universities, IITs, and IIMs, 40% faculty positions are vacant. It is also shocking to note that as many as 57% of our college teachers do not either have a master or PhD degree. Our educational system completely lacks innovation and creativity, and we continue to have examinations which are memory-based and which merely test a person's or a student's mugging up abilities. There was a time when Indian universities like Nalanda, Vikram, and Takshila were widely known for their rigorous academic curricula and excellence. Chinese traveler Huyen Song and Moorish traveler Ibn Battuta visited these temples of learning to study our education system. These universities produce some of the finest minds. The holy Vedas and philosophical Upanishads, too, were the scholarly works of people who graduated from our gurukuls. It is a matter of grave concern that today we do not have any world-class university. In fact, Philip G. Elbeck has observed that India is a world-class country without a world-class university. Today, there are serious concerns as to quality of our universities. Times Higher Education, you know, repeatedly they will rate top 200 universities and none of us are there. The philosophical increase in the student strength, the phenomenal increase in the student strength has resulted in high requirements of infrastructure, facilities, and finances. But one is at pains to say that while the student population of country did increase in the geometrical proportion, the financial allocation by the government have increased at best in arithmetical progression, causing havoc with the quality of our education. No one can dispute much greater attention and new sources for generation of resources are vital to ensure the quality of higher education, and public funding alone would not be adequate to meet this challenge. Economic liberalization and globalization has imposed certain additional obligations on the higher education sector. A massive training of manpower is urgently needed to keep pace with the newer technologies and fast-changing global market. This would necessitate expansion of specialized institutions in the subsector of higher and technical education and vocationalization of education at secondary stages. Most universities are struggling to survive in the face of increasing enrollment and growing complexities of new types of academic programs. In our cultural traditions, teaching or educating has always been considered as a sacred task and service to humanity. In fact, Kabir has given teacher a place higher than even God. And since God is giver and not taker, the education should also come for free. It was during the British period that the government funding of education started, and by and large, we continue to follow the same model. But today, because of new socio-economic realities of globalization, it has become difficult for governments throughout the globe to continue to provide liberal financial support to higher education sector. In fact, governments in all countries of the world, including developed world, are finding it difficult to sustain public education institutions. As a matter of fact, the size of higher education sector has outgrown the capacity of governments to finance it. In our country, recognition of larger social benefits which primary and elementary education brings in comparison to higher education was the other reason because of which government shifted its focus to invest more in these sectors rather than higher education. This situation has led to privatization of higher education. We have no choice but to privatize and globalize higher education by forging partnership with big business houses to produce employable, skilled graduates. It is unfortunate many of us continue to look down at private universities, people like us who are always in a public university. We must know that best universities of the United States are private universities. And in any case, even in India, most of us have been educated in the so-called public schools, which indeed is a misnomer as we were educated in private English medium schools. So school education is already in private hands. The country has seen establishment of large number of deemed universities under Section 3 of the UGC Act, of private universities through state enactments. The National Knowledge Commission has suggested that we should have 1,500 additional universities, and with government not having enough resources, we have no option but to establish these universities in the private sector. Private presence in higher education did get a flip in the last two decades. In 2001, private unaided institutions made up to 42.6% of all higher education institutions, and 32.8% of students received education in these.